with the police or EMTs alongside those situations. But if it is a dangerous situation, we do typically recommend calling police first. But if that person is willing, compliant, you can give us a call and bypass the police altogether, or you can give us a call and call the police if you feel the situation will escalate. Hope that answers some questions.
Yeah, thank you. This is one of those where I don't know, and maybe the police and the EMTs can tell us how many of these kinds of situations exist. I mean, if it's even, you know, 20% of what they're doing, it would seem to me that the resources could be better spent elsewhere, and it would be a less stressful situation for everyone. And my guess is it's probably a higher percentage, because there's, once people reach that point, a lot of them are more than willing to go get help. So thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Sterla. I believe we have a question from Representative Schlossberg.
The chairman asked it, actually.
Okay. Any other questions here in the room? I have one question. District Attorney had referenced his view for the need for an increased pool of resources for police, and I'm sympathetic to that point of view. And I just want to see if he's observing what I'm observing. So I'm starting to hear from my local municipalities. We know that with COVID-19, that there's been a tanking of state and local revenues. We see that at the state level, we're looking at potentially a $5 billion hole. And municipalities are experiencing something similar at their scale. And so one of my big concerns is that as Washington Congress talks about and negotiates over potentially another stimulus package, what is on the bubble is whether state and local governments will receive any help from Washington in this round. And there are some voices saying that there shouldn't be any. And my concern is that if revenues are tanking at the local level, which they are, there are few places for municipalities to go other than their safety forces. This is where layoffs happen, police, fire, et cetera. And so as we contemplate perhaps the need for an increasing pool of revenue sources, resources for police, we may actually experience the exact opposite of that. Because Washington fails to act, there's no money given, the local revenues have tanked. So I'm just interested whether the district attorney is hearing from municipalities in Delaware County that are concerned about their revenue picture and what that means for safety forces in the future, and whether he shares that concern of if there isn't help from Washington, we may see a defunding.
Yes, Representative, I absolutely completely agree with you. That is a major concern and should be a major concern for anybody who believes that we need to do public safety and have proper public safety in our communities. Let me just say that in Delaware County, we have one municipality that's classified as a city, and that's the city of Chester, which every year makes the list of one of the top most violent cities in America. Deep, deep poverty, third or fourth generation poverty exists in this city, and there is violent crime. They've already had over 20 homicides this year alone. And it is a deep concern because the city is now flat broke. They were trying to get out of receivership, out of Act 47, which they've been trying for years to get. We're on the verge of doing that, and the pandemic hit, and the revenues just completely tanked. The governor had to appoint another receiver. Public safety is being prioritized, but there is simply no money at this point to fund that. My office, through our asset forfeiture program, are making sure that we're keeping police officers on the street in the city of Chester. But this is going to happen to all of the communities across Pennsylvania. The federal government absolutely has to come through and help support state and local governments, or public safety will be at issue.
Thank you for lending your strong voice to that. Appreciate that. I do want to mention that we have been joined by our caucus chairwoman, Representative Joanna McClinton. And we also have a question here in the room from Representative Boyle.
Thank you, Representative Longetti. Recently, there's been a focus on reimagining policing. And I think many people have been surprised to learn that just 5% of calls to police forces are related to violence. And so much of the training that we have police officers go through deals with acts of violence and combating violence, but probably not enough is not enough training is done on domestic issues and also mental health issues. And I was curious if there was any data that anyone from Delaware County had in relation to the background of police officers in that county. What percentage of police in Delaware County would have a degree in psychology or social work? Because to me, that should be a prerequisite for a job in a police force. Thank you.
So I'll answer your question. I don't think there's anybody who has that data because, again, we have more than 41 different municipal police departments. Each have their own hiring practices. So I don't think that there is any countywide data. I will say that our Police Chiefs Association here in Delaware County is working to make sure that our officers are as trained as best they can in the modern 21st century policing techniques, so that our officers are trained to be guardians, not warriors. And that they do have the skill set to deal with the kind of issues we're talking about today. But again, we have 41 different police departments. We have some very small municipalities that have part-time officers. We have the Upper Darby Police Department of 144 officers who work in the sixth most populous municipality in Pennsylvania. It's a wide variety of police departments, and there's a whole different series of skill sets that are needed. It's a much different experience being a police officer in my town, Haverford Township, for example, than it is in the city of Chester, or even right next door in Upper Darby Township. So different officers have different skill sets. And that's one of the things our task force is dealing with right now in Delaware County, is how do we best prepare our officers to do the 21st century policing that we're requiring them to do, to be community police officers and first responders at the same time. And it's not an easy task, and I really am proud of the people who work for us in Delaware County because they are doing it very well, in my opinion.
Thank you for the answer, DA, and we've never met before, but you're doing really good work there, and you have a lot of admirers. I do just want to reiterate just how different American police forces are compared to police forces in Europe and in Asia, and I think that we can learn a lot about policing from other countries. Thank you.
Representative, can I just follow up one thing? I think you're exactly right. We can learn a lot from other jurisdictions in other countries, but we also have to keep in mind that we live in a country where we have a tremendous amount of guns and weapons of mass destruction that are available to almost any citizen. We live in, I think, the most heavily armed civilian population in the world. And our police officers who have to go out there every day facing that, not knowing what's going to happen with any particular stop or any particular call of service, they really earn my admiration for the work that they do. And I think that we need to talk about that as well. The fear of violence to them because of our inability to get a handle on the gun violence in our country.
Absolutely. And I represent the city of Philadelphia and have a district
Sure.
with many police officers. And so many of the issues that you see combat veterans have in relation to PTSD, you would have police officers have those sort of issues just due to the violence that we have in our communities. And you're 100% right. It gets back to guns. This is a incredibly well-armed country, and police officers have to live with that. And we need to advocate for them by having some common sense gun control.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We do have a follow-up question from Representative Amar.
Thank you, Representative Longetti. So, Jack, I actually have a follow-up question for you, and you might not know the answer. I'm just kind of putting it out there. So I had multiple veterans contact my office And this happened at the VA in Wilmington, so it might be different in Pennsylvania. But they went to the VA to seek mental health care. The VA determined that they needed to be committed, either voluntary or involuntary. But both, and no matter what, how it happened, they were escorted to a hospital in the back of a state trooper's vehicle, handcuffed, even though they went to the VA in seeking help. So my question is, in Pennsylvania, do we require that same sort of treatment? Because I feel like I know some of those veterans personally, and it made it worse, even just in that transport, because that made them feel like they were committing a crime when they were really going to the VA to ask for help. So that's actually what spurred me to even start talking about this, was the number of veterans that had that happen. Again, I'll say it was the Wilmington VA, not in Pennsylvania, but I don't know how common that is.
That's the first I've ever heard of that, and I'm shocked, to be honest with you. There would be no reason to keep that person handcuffed unless there was some other facts that we don't know about, that they presented some threat to the officers. We can talk to the state police commander, but I don't think the policy of the state police would allow them to handcuff somebody who was being brought in for 302. I certainly don't think our municipal police departments would treat a citizen that way. But again, not knowing all of the facts, I do think the officers are always having to be wary of making sure that people are safe, and in particular, they're safe. So whenever you're dealing with somebody you know has a mental health problem, I think it does raise the awareness and probably raises the trepidation of some of the officers involved. But Jen, this is exactly why this conversation has to happen, because maybe those officers weren't properly trained. Maybe they weren't following the policies. Maybe there isn't a policy. I think you guys would be in better position than us to get a response from the Pennsylvania State Police.
Yeah, I'm going to look into it with the.
And if there is, Representative, I think we should share that with all of our municipal police departments. So I think it's a great way for us to continue to have this conversation, have it be meaningful.
Okay, thank you, District Attorney. I appreciate it.
Okay, thank you, and thank you to our first panel. We appreciate all your time and your testimony. We are going to move now to our second panel. We have three testifiers. Corey Seelhammer is the Mental Health Program Specialist and Certified Crisis Intervention Team Coordinator for Franklin Fulton County Office of Mental Health / Intellectual and Developmental Disability / Early Intervention. Nikki Dawson is the Advocacy Director for the National Alliance on Mental Health Illness, Keystone PA. And Elizabeth Sinclair Hank is the Director of Research for the Treatment Advocacy Center. So we'll go to our next panel. Of Corey, if you want to begin the testimony.
It won't let me turn my camera on. Okay. There, I got it.
Oh, great. We can hear you and see you.
Perfect. Well, thank you for the invitation. I'm always excited to be able to talk about our program. I'm going to try and keep it to 10 minutes to give the folks behind me opportunity to speak as well. But I'm going to talk about our CIT, our Crisis Intervention Team here in Franklin County. Began in 2013 when a core team of seven of us went to the Laurel Highlands regions where we were trained, brought the training back to Franklin, Fulton County, and to date, we have held 10 40-hour a week trainings for over 180 individuals. So our current team is made up of law enforcement, first responders, 911 dispatchers, probation officers, our correction officers, some folks out of the hospital. But over half of our team is law enforcement and first responders. Recognizing, I believe Nikki's going to talk about CIT and our subscribes to the Memphis model, so I'm going to kind of go over our program more and let her do that. But recognizing that CIT was more than just training, it's a relationship between law enforcement, the mental health community. We entertained the idea of a co-responder model. So our advisory committee, we looked at our 911 data and our suicide statistics locally here, and kind of identified some areas in our community that look like could use some extra supports and resources. Those police departments that were in those areas, there was three of them. The police chiefs and sergeants were involved with the development of our program from the ground up, as far as doing the request for proposals, doing the interviews for the actual co-responder person. So they were bought into the program from the very beginning. They were a part of creating it. We were fortunate enough in 2017 to be awarded a two-year grant from PCCB to pilot our co-responder model. So what we did then was embed a mental health professional inside three of our local police departments. When I say embed, I mean they gave her desk and space, and that's where she goes each morning. She goes in and checks in with her departments. She works out of their departments. She's available for ride-alongs or to go on live calls. She's there to make follow-up visits or follow-up calls, maybe to calls they had the evening before and thought that maybe mental health or community engagement could be a resource or an option as opposed to criminal justice involvement. For our goal, our goals for our two-year grant, we wanted to see 80 persons in 2 years and get 75 of them to participate in community-based services. Within 4 months, we had seen 80 people, and within 8 months, we had 75 participating in community-based services. Our final goal was to reduce the number of follow-up contacts with law enforcement. And at the end of our two-year grant period, 92% of the folks we encountered did not have further contact with law enforcement. Because we saw such positive movement, we went and were able to secure some funds for a second co-responder. So we now have two co-responders inside of four of our police departments. That covers roughly about 34% of Franklin County. A lot of our areas are left uncovered. Some of the calls or the incidences that they might respond are largely behavior, some suicide, domestic violence. We have those, I think 911 referred to them as high utilizers or frequent callers, homelessness. I have a few stories to share with you of what it looks like, what an actual call might look like for someone. We had an incident with a gentleman that one of our police departments was called just because of bizarre behavior. Like it was mentioned, neighbors might call. He was picking flowers from various yards, stopping women, giving them flowers, and making inappropriate suggestions. Over the course of the next 9 days, he had contact with four additional police departments in our communities. For reason, he was kissing a fast food clerk, going through the trash, peering in the school windows, and even stole a wedding cake. So we were able to get the co-responder involved to help him and his wife, actually, what needed to happen. He was actually able to get an appointment with a psychiatrist, get a treatment plan, get going what works for him. We were able to get him referred to the Veterans Administration so that he could get benefits through there. Got him hooked up with case management, helped figure out some insurance stuff. And after that, he has not had repeat contact with the police. We've had officers on the scene, and from being a part of CIT and training and just having that relationship, wasn't feeling real comfortable about the call. It was a mental distress call. So he called the co-responder, and she talked to the lady over the phone and was able to ask her the question, are you feeling suicidal? And her response was yes. And when she asked if she had a plan, she said, yes, I have a loaded handgun in my desk upstairs. She was able to talk to her and get her to go with the officer to crisis to be assessed and to get some treatment. Had that officer not recognized or had options available to him, it might not have gone quite as smoothly. We make referral, they can get him involved with things, housing, different assistance, the physical health end. Things that our officers get called for is just baffled me once we became involved and started looking at things. Our police officers shouldn't have to try and navigate our mental health system because it's not easy. They have special skills that we need to keep out on the streets and let the mental health folks take care of those things. And to date, as of July 31st, I can share that through our 4 to 5 years that we've been going strong, we've seen over 800 individuals, and 91% of them have not had repeat contact with law enforcement. So our hope is to continue to grow our program here in Franklin County. One of our police chiefs, his quote to me was, now we have options and we have resources that are available to us that we just didn't know about before. And we will continue that relationship, and hopefully post-COVID or in our new world, we can again resume our trainings and keep growing our team. So that's all I have for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Corey. We'll next move to Nikki Dawson.
Good morning, Chairman Sterla, Chairman Kinsey, and members of the House Democratic Policy Committee. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to testify at this important hearing on mental health and police response, and special thanks to Representative O'Mara for bringing us all together. My name is Nikki Dawson, and I'm the Advocacy Director of the State Organization for the National Alliance on Mental Illness, NAMI Keystone, Pennsylvania. NAMI is the largest grassroots mental health organization dedicated to building better lives for the millions of Americans affected by mental illness. We have 31 affiliates in Pennsylvania with over 1,000 members engaging in support, education, and advocacy on mental health issues. Our members are primarily people who live with mental illness, their family members, mental health professionals, and advocates. As a grassroots mental health advocacy organization, we know the realities of stigma, prejudice, and discrimination against those with mental health conditions. NAMI is committed to the principle that all individuals, including people of color and people with mental illness, should be treated with respect and dignity, that they deserve equitable health outcomes and full inclusion. Most importantly, we believe in help, not handcuffs. For far too long, law enforcement has been the response to people experiencing symptoms of mental illness, which can lead to devastating outcomes. This is unacceptable. Our mental health system provides too little, too late, and then law enforcement steps in as first responders in mental health emergencies. We must work toward a system that provides a mental health response to mental health crises, and we cannot afford to ignore the role that law enforcement plays. That is why NAMI has long supported crisis intervention teams as a model that has inspired communities and law enforcement to help make crisis response safer, more compassionate, and focused on connecting people to care. CIT, or the Memphis model, was introduced in Memphis, Tennessee in the late 80s in response to the tragic death of a young African-American male with a history of mental illness at the hands of white law enforcement. At the time, officers were trained only in the use of deadly force when their lives were in perceived danger. Memphis PD began working with a group of community stakeholders, the local NAMI Memphis affiliate, mental health providers, consumers, and their families. The goal was to develop a community response that was more intelligent, understandable, and most importantly, a safe approach to mental health crisis events. The result was a safer response to police encounters of people with mental illness in a manner consistent with recognizing mental illness as a disease and not a crime. Since that time, CIT has gained wide recognition as a leading evidence-based practice that involves individuals from all aspects of the crisis continuum, working with law enforcement and emergency personnel to educate for better outcomes. Leading the Commonwealth effort to bring CIT statewide, the PCCD currently maps 35 CIT county locations in Pennsylvania and hosts an annual meeting bringing together all program leads and trainers. Additionally, in 2015, PCCD brought the Memphis team to Pennsylvania, so 50 individuals could receive the train-the-trainer version of CIT to support the continued expansion in Pennsylvania. In 1988, NAMI provided the seed money to develop CIT and remains an essential partner and promoter of the Memphis model, especially here in Pennsylvania. Both Philadelphia and Pittsburgh have established CIT programs with NAMI volunteer supporters involved. The Philadelphia Police Department boasts a robust CIT program coordinated by a NAMI volunteer and various training components provided by consumers and family members with lived experience. NAMI Keystone PA, formerly NAMI Southwestern PA, brought the CIT program to the City of Pittsburgh Police Department over 20 years ago, and the partnership continues to this day. As the state NAMI organization in Pennsylvania, we were to be the NAMI host, along with the City of Pittsburgh Police Department, for the 2020 CIT International Conference. The conference was moved to a virtual platform due to COVID-19 concerns, but the conference will return to Pittsburgh in 2022. I also wanted to take this time to highlight the work of our NAMI affiliate in Northeastern PA to develop a regional CIT program. In 2009, after a woman with schizophrenia had an encounter with police that ended in her death, NAMI Scranton wrote a letter to the mayor asking what could we do. The mayor formed a task force of law enforcement, mental health professionals, and family members. The executive director of NAMI Scranton introduced the CIT model as an option for police training. The task force pulled resources together to have a team of stakeholders trained to develop and coordinate the program. It has evolved into the Northeastern PA CIT program and is coordinated by the executive director of NAMI Scranton in Northeastern Pennsylvania. They do at least 1 to 2 trainings a year and have trained nearly 350 police officers, dispatchers, EMTs, and parole officers since 2010. The program covers Lackawanna, Susquehanna, and Wayne counties. A community nonprofit partner acquired a grant used to fund the training to cover the police department expenses and sending their officers to a week-long training. The Northeastern PA CIT program also conducted a train-the-trainer class for neighboring Luzerne and Wyoming counties so they could begin their own CIT program. The executive director of NAMI Luzerne Wyoming PA sits on their CIT advisory board. Additionally, the Northeastern program has reduced the use of force by 66% since the program began in 2010. Also, NAMI Scranton Northeastern PA holds an Evening of Hope every year and gives a CIT team leadership award to a member of the law enforcement community. Another effective model gaining widespread recognition is CAHOOTS, or Crisis Assistance Helping Out on the Street. It has been in use for more than 30 years and was developed in Eugene, Oregon by the Whiteboard Clinic. The program uses two-person teams consisting of a medic, a crisis worker, with substantial training and experience in the mental health field. The teams are trained to deal with a wide range of mental health-related crises, including conflict resolution, welfare checks, substance abuse, suicide threats, and more, relying on trauma-informed de-escalation and harm reduction techniques. In Eugene, the CAHOOTS teams are dispatched through non-emergency crisis lines as well as 911, and in 2019 alone, police were only requested roughly 250 times out of nearly 24,000 calls. Additionally, the program savings to the Eugene Police Department have averaged $8.5 million since its inception, with an additional savings of $14 million in medical expenses by diverting individuals away from emergency departments and into appropriate community services. The model is widely used throughout the Pacific Northwest, but has gained national attention in recent years, with more and more cities working to adopt similar models. San Francisco, California, Albuquerque, New Mexico, Indianapolis, New York, and Atlanta, Georgia are already seeking to develop their own programs. And locally, it has caught the attention of the Philadelphia Police Department as they look to strengthen community relations in the midst of social unrest stemming from continued instances in which African Americans are dying at the hands of white law enforcement. We cannot ignore the disproportionate negative effects of policing on communities of color or the critical and intersecting role mental health plays. People with mental health conditions know all too well what it means to experience stigma, but not all of us know the doubling role race can play. Growing calls for racial justice have opened up the conversation about the role of law enforcement in public health, specifically mental health, and how it affects communities of color. Unarmed Black people are killed by law enforcement at a rate 5 times that of unarmed white folks. and nearly one in four people killed by police officers in 2019 had a mental health condition. If we are going to change outcomes, we need to disrupt the system that puts police at the forefront of crisis response. But complex problems require complex solutions. To provide a continuum of mental health care that helps people get and stay well, NAMI believes we need to focus on several areas of community mental health that include comprehensive and culturally competent crisis care, readily accessible inpatient and outpatient care options for those who need it, investment in social supports and services to help people stay well, and a system of care based on trauma-informed principles that is available to everyone. Both the CIT and the COOTS models are extensive in providing appropriate education to those who are certified in the delivery, but another key element to their success is the ability to provide community-based services in a timely manner. Although a wide array, not capacity, of services exists in more urban areas of Pennsylvania, rural and frontier communities often rely on emergency services to care for mental health needs. Absence of appropriate resources can result in the exacerbation of acute illness and lead to long delays in engagement of appropriate care. On July 30th, 2020, the Pennsylvania Joint State Commission published a report highlighting the inefficiencies of the current behavioral health system in the Commonwealth. Behavioral health care system capacity in Pennsylvania and its impact on hospital emergency departments and patient health was established by H.R. 268 to closely examine and offer practical solutions to several areas across the continuum of behavioral health care. It should also be noted that I have the distinct honor of participating in the advisory committee to the Joint State Commission. Particular attention was paid by us to the lack of community-based and crisis services across the Commonwealth, especially in areas designated as a health provider shortage area, or HPSA. Lack of these services is shown to lead to higher utilization of emergency services to include police contact, increased recidivism, and overall poor mental health outcomes. Although we are here today to discuss the police response in a mental health crisis, I would be remiss if I did not mention the emergency services system as a whole. Although crisis lines exist nationally and across the Commonwealth, most emergency encounters begin with a call to 911. At this time, the operator must quickly assess the situation and gather critical details to pass along for dispatch. It is then the job of dispatch to decide appropriate resources to allocate to the call. Depending on location, again, these resources can vary drastically, with more urban and suburban areas having the ability to dispatch specially trained crisis personnel, whereas in more rural areas, EMTs and paramedics are the ones most likely to respond. Throughout this process, it is very likely or very unlikely few individuals have the appropriate training to deal with a mental health crisis. As mandated in Pennsylvania, only the highest supervisory roles, both in the 911 call center and emergency medical services, receive any type of mental health related training. In short, expanding mental health crisis response training to include all first responders on the continuum would be immensely beneficial in preventing a potentially tragic event by ensuring an appropriate response to each call. First responders trained in crisis intervention can be lifesavers, but they are a reaction to a fundamental flaw in how we respond to mental health crises. Instead, the answer is investment in a comprehensive mental health care system that demonstrates cultural competence and equitable treatment. We must partner with law enforcement to vastly improve the interactions that still occur, but we also must work to effect the significant change that is needed. NAMI has long promoted and supported training in mental health and de-escalation for law enforcement, advocated for changes in agency policies and procedures, and pushed to create community partnerships to divert people from justice involvement. With more than 30 affiliates across the Commonwealth, NAMI Keystone PA stands ready to collaborate and assist with local, county, and state government and law enforcement, as well as PCCD, the legislature, and the administration in ensuring safe policing for all Pennsylvanians. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Nikki. And we'll next move to our next testifier, Elizabeth Sinclair Hank.
Yes, Chairman Representative O'Mara and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify before you today regarding this timely and important topic on law enforcement's role in mental health crisis response. My name is Elizabeth Hank, and I am here representing the Treatment Advocacy Center, a national nonprofit dedicated to eliminating barriers to treatment for people with severe mental illness. I am also here as a citizen of Pennsylvania with a special interest in the actions of this committee residing in Philadelphia. I am the Director of Research at the Treatment Advocacy Center, where I lead the Office of Research and Public Affairs. We conduct policy research on the impact of severe mental illness on public service systems with the goal of increasing the public's understanding of severe mental illness. The Treatment Advocacy Center has more than 20 years of research experience in a variety of topics regarding severe mental illness. Relevant to today's hearing includes our research work in the role of law enforcement in mental illness crisis response and how people with severe mental illness are overrepresented in the criminal justice system. For example, in Pennsylvania, there are almost 16,000 people with severe mental illness in the state's jails and prisons, which is more than 10 times the number of people remaining in the state psychiatric hospitals. People with severe mental illness are 16 times more likely to be shot and killed by police than people without mental illness, according to our research. A large driver of this disparity is due to the disproportionate volume of contact between individuals with severe mental illness and law enforcement. Therefore, reducing the number of contacts between law enforcement officers and people with severe mental illness is the single most immediate practical strategy to reduce fatal police encounters for individuals with mental illness. Law enforcement officers are on the front lines of psychiatric care, charged with responding to, handling, and even preventing mental illness crises. This is in part due to the limited community treatment options and the continuing shortage of psychiatric inpatient beds. This results in people in need of mental health treatment not being able to receive care until a crisis occurs and law enforcement intervenes. The role of law enforcement in mental illness crisis response is an enormous portion of police department resources and budgets. Responding to and transporting individuals with mental illness occupies more than one-fifth of law enforcement officers' time, according to an analysis we did in 2019. This time is a result of the overrepresentation of people with mental illness in the criminal justice system, the length of time mental health crisis service calls take, the long distances law enforcement must travel in order to find available community mental health resources, and the time officers must wait while transporting individuals in crisis to an emergency department. Based on the qualitative analysis of the results, the lack of appropriate mental health treatment services in the community is the most prominent factor contributing to law enforcement's outsized role in mental health crisis response. There are several potential solutions to reduce the burden on law enforcement in responding to mental health crises, several of which that are already available to the estimated 335,000 individuals with severe mental illness in the state of Pennsylvania, and that we've already heard about today. As well, there's a variety of different national evidence-based practices and examples throughout the country. For example, law enforcement-based specialized response, such as crisis intervention team, or CIT, is a very effective law enforcement program. The executive director of CIT International, Ron Bruno from Utah, has worked in his state to connect the 911 call center to mobile crisis teams to allow better coordination on dispatch. Law enforcement-based specialized mental health response include co-responder models. In Tucson, Arizona, there is a great program, evidence of this program. I did a ride-along with our mental health support team last year, and in fact was highlighted in the Philadelphia Citizen earlier this week. They have a dedicated unit to respond to mental health calls and utilize social workers as co-responders, therefore reducing the trauma associated with these calls. Mental health-based specialized mental illness response, such as mobile crisis teams. We already heard from the program in Delaware County, the Crisis Connects teams. These are really vital to provide linkages and support through the fragmented mental health system. In Virginia, they established in 2018 an alternative transport program to allow individuals to be transported to services not requiring law enforcement and emergency medical services, using secure transport for service calls equivalent to 302 in Pennsylvania. Representative O'Mara, unfortunately, your question earlier didn't surprise me. In some jurisdictions, law enforcement are required to utilize handcuffs when transporting, even for mental health calls. But these alternatives to non-emergency transport provide an alternative to that issue. Centralized crisis centers often offer an alternative to jail or crowded emergency departments by being accessible, providing quick intake and drop-off procedures for law enforcement. Delaware County has such a program called the Crisis Response Center, and this Crisis Response Center is also vital to the Tucson, Arizona model I mentioned earlier. Telepsychiatry allows co-responder models to exist in more rural areas. A great example of this is a program in Nebraska where they utilize technology and iPads in order to bring the mental health clinicians to law enforcement on a service call that they can't physically get to. Just across the river in Camden, New Jersey, they utilize a data integration system to address their high utilizer population by linking police and mental health data in order to identify people and prevent law enforcement and mental health contacts. It is important to note the analysis of the 2019 survey results uncovered that on average, more than one quarter of transports of individuals with severe mental illness conducted by law enforcement were for high utilizers, or individuals who had three or more service encounters with law enforcement in a 1 month period. High utilizers are often found to be individuals with severe mental illness who cannot, on their own, recognize their need for treatment, no matter how clear the symptoms may be to others. This lack of insight, also referred to as anosognosia, has been identified as a primary factor in treatment non-adherence and impacts as many as half of individuals with bipolar disorder or schizophrenia. As a result, these individuals often find themselves caught in the revolving door of hospitalization and incarceration. In 2018, the Pennsylvania General Assembly passed legislation to amend the Mental Health Procedures Act to authorize counties to implement assisted outpatient treatment, or AOT, programs. AOT is the practice of placing individuals with severe mental illness who have a history of treatment non-adherence and inpatient hospitalization under a non-punitive civil court order to follow a prescribed treatment plan while living in the community. AOT is proven to reduce individuals' contact with law enforcement, as well as the incidence and duration of psychiatric hospitalization, homelessness, and incarceration. Additionally, it improves the health and social outcomes of individuals with severe mental illness by allowing earlier intervention to help prevent the revolving door of hospitalization and incarceration. Finally, AOT has been shown to save money. Despite the fact that the bill passed the Pennsylvania General Assembly unanimously, to date, not one county in the state has taken advantage of the law. Representative O'Meara and members of the committee, I thank you for the attention on this important issue, and I am available to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you all for your testimony, and this time we will turn to questions. And are there any questions for members that are here in the room today? The panel has left our room speechless, which is, that doesn't happen very often. But we do have a question from Representative O'Mara.
Thank you, Representative Longjetti. Thank you to all three of the panelists. I am furiously taking notes over here. So I have, well, first, Elizabeth, you just said to me something that was startling. So no counties have taken advantage of the AOT, and do you know why that is, or do you have any insight to that? That's something I wish the DA just heard, but he's newly elected, so I'm going to go talk to him about this after.
Yes, great question, Representative O'Mara. All counties have opted out. It is important to note that a county that has already opted out, and they're required to, due to the law, they are required to opt in or opt out once a year. However, they can opt in at any time. Okay. So, you know, we have heard that my organization also provides technical assistance to implement these programs throughout the country. There is a federal grant program that gives seed money to counties in order to implement these programs. However, you know, we urge many counties throughout the state to apply for this federal program, and to our knowledge, not one county took advantage of that.
Wow. Okay. Well, that's something we can try to address. Now, I think my next question is probably for Nikki. So I'm just wondering, you mentioned a lot of CIT programs and specifically talked about in the Northeast. Do you know of any collaborative efforts to implement CIT programs or CIT training in the Southeast or in Philadelphia and the collar counties?
Oh, I apologize. I didn't realize I had covered. I know Philadelphia, we have a NAMI in Philadelphia that they have been working locally. In Philadelphia County, I know Bucks County is also heavily involved in any CIT training that goes on within that county. So, but I'm not sure or aware of a coordinated effort to bring it to all of Southeast Pennsylvania.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And I'm probably going to follow up with Corey and privately, because what you've done in Franklin County sounds truly remarkable, and I want to see how we can model some of that work in other states. So I will definitely be following, or in other counties, I will be following up with you individually. So thank you all very much for your insight and your wonderful presentations this morning. Thank you, Rep. Longetti.
Thank you. We'll next move to Chairman Sterla for a question.
Thank you. So it sounds like the program that no county is taking advantage of actually has a little bit of cost to it, but some of that might be able to be offset by federal grants. Is there any way that counties can go together do like could the County Commissioners Association do one large block grant that would get it to maybe available for, you know, a half a dozen counties or a dozen counties so that they could show that it actually works and act as a demonstration for some of the other counties. Is anything like that possible?
Yes, thank you for your question, Chairman Sterla. Yes, that is a great way to, especially, sort of pilot the assisted outpatient treatment program and be able to show that it does, in fact, save money to the jurisdictions that implement it, because it is a much more efficient way of providing care to these individuals that are already, as I mentioned, cycling through the systems and costing, costing the taxpayers quite a lot of money. And so, the assisted outpatient treatment program has been shown to save money in the long run, but it does in some places require some, initial startup to begin. So I think that is a great, great idea, and happy to work with you on that.
Okay, any other questions either here in the room or remotely? Okay. I certainly want to thank all of our panelists for this very valuable and timely information. And at this point, I want to turn it over to Representative O'Mara and give her an opportunity for some closing remarks. And thank you for calling this hearing.
Thank you very much, Representative Longetti. In closing, I want to thank all of our panelists. I think I learned a lot of valuable information. Unfortunately, I think that I also have a longer to-do list now than I did before this hearing began. I really am going to work on exploring this, how we can expand this AOT program in the state, and going to explore the 302 policy further. So if any of my colleagues are interested in working with me on any of these issues, please let me know. But otherwise, I just want to thank you and everyone who tuned in. Mental health is a huge issue, and we have to work together to both educate the community and also break the stigma. It's okay to have a mental health issue, and it's okay to ask for help. And my goal is to make it easier for people when they do decide to do that. So thank you all so much for your time this morning, and I look forward to working with many of you as we move forward. Thank you, Representative Longetti.
Thank you, and that will conclude our hearing, and the meeting is adjourned.